Welcome back to the lecture series. This is Dr. Prema bringing you the lecture series on power quality brought to you by VTU eShikshana. So this is the fourth lecture of the module 4 of the course power quality. And the module 4 is applied harmonics. We have seen in the last three lectures the topics such as harmonic distortion evaluation, harmonic control, and where to control harmonics, and then the harmonic studies. So in the last lecture, we saw the harmonic studies and what is the actual need of the harmonic study, what are the objectives of the harmonic study, and what is the procedure by which we do the harmonic study. We also saw how to model the system and how to model harmonic sources. And I was just explaining you the methods or the computer tools by which we can do harmonic studies. And today we will continue that topic, that is the computer tools used for harmonic studies. Also, we will start with the topic devices to control harmonics. So today in the lecture, we'll be going through the following topics. We will first see the main computer tools which are used for harmonic study. Then we will describe the working of the devices used for controlling harmonics, such as inline chokes, zigzag transformers. We will also try to see some filters which are used for producing the harmonics in the system. So let us go to the first topic, which is the computer tools used for analysis of harmonics. So to use any computer tools which are commonly available to study the harmonics and do the analysis of harmonics, the analyst must describe the system configuration, the circuit configuration. So he should know the circuit configuration. He should know the details about the load and the sources of the program. So that means before doing the computer analysis, we need to collect some data which need to be inputted into the system. So what are those data which must be collected before we do the analysis? They are listed here. We need line and transformer impedances, which are very important to do the harmonic analysis. Then we need to know the transformer connections, whether they are connected in delta or in star. And then we should know the values of the capacitive bands. And we should also know where exactly the capacitive bands are placed. That is also one important, very important data what we need. Then we should know the harmonic spectra of the nonlinear load. As I told, we need not know the details or the working of the nonlinear loads exactly, but we need to know how much harmonics the loads are producing. We should know the harmonic spectra of the nonlinear load. We should also know the power source voltage. So these are the data which we need to collect before we do the analysis, harmonic analysis using any computer tool. So what are the data? We need the transformer and line impedances. We need the connections of the transformer. We need to know the details of the connections of the transformer. We need to know how many capacitor banks are there, what are the values of the capacitor banks, and where exactly they are located. We also know to know down the harmonic spectra of the nonlinear loop. Also, we need to know the voltages which are provided by the power source. So once we know these values will be entered into the program, which will automatically adjust the impedances for the frequency, and it will compute the harmonic flow throughout the system. So for that, to do the analysis completely, we need to give these data to the system. Now let us see what are the main requirements for a program should have in order to analyze the harmonics. So we have listed some criteria or the requirements to be, or we can even say the characteristics that the computer program should have to perform harmonic analysis. So the first thing is that it should be capable of handling large networks with at least several hundreds of nodes, because we are going to deal with the distribution system. And so we need to, sometimes we will have to model a very large system. So the computer program should be capable of handling large networks. So with a few hundreds of nodes in it. Then the computer program should be capable of handling multi-phase models, like multi-phase models of any arbitrary structure. You don't know how the structure is going to be, so it should be capable of handling arbitrary structures. Mostly not the utility distribution feeders will not be agreeable to accurately get a solution for balanced positive sequence components. So that's the reason we say that it should have capability to model arbitrary structure and multi-phase model. And then the system should be capable of modeling systems with a positive sequence model. Then there are no zero sequence. There is no need of having the zero sequence. So in the last lecture, we have seen where we need to have a zero sequence, where we need to have positive or negative sequence. So the system should be able to model positive sequence models. And then the system should be able to perform this frequency scan. This is very important. It should be able to perform the frequency scan at a very small frequency of 10 kilohertz, because that is basically the increment of the frequency in the harmonic spectra. So if you want to model, or if you want to plot the harmonic spectra of any particular system, then the system should be capable of sampling the frequencies at a very low value, like 10 hertz, so that we can get the harmonic spectrum, and we should know exactly where the resonance happens, which frequency has the resonance in it. So to identify the resonance in the system, we need to scan for a very small interval of frequency, say 10 hertz. Okay, so that is also another requirement. And then the system should be capable of performing simultaneous simulation of numeric harmonic sources, because we don't know how many nonlinear loads are present in the system. Suppose if you are taking a very large system, there can be many nonlinear loads present in the system. So the system should be able to simultaneously model or simulate every harmonic source in the system, and then it should be able to estimate the actual harmonic current and the voltage distortion in the system. So this is another requirement. Also, the system should have inbuilt model for the harmonic sources. So as I told, we cannot model every power electronic converters or every nonlinear load, right? So it should if the computer program what we are using has inbuilt models for the nonlinear sources or the harmonic sources, then it would be very easy for us. Okay, so the system should be having inbuilt model for the harmonic sources. Also, it should have the current source and voltage source models for the harmonic, because sometimes we will have to represent the nonlinear loads as a current source, or sometimes we need to represent it as a voltage source. So it should be able to model in either as a voltage source or as a current source. Then the system should be able to automatically adjust the phase angles of the sources based on the fundamental frequency phase angle. So that phase angle adjustment has to be done. It should be capable of doing that. Then the system should be able to model the transformer connection. So the transformer connections should be available, so that we can use that whenever we want. So the system should be having, or at least we should be able to model different transformer connections. And the last one is, it should be able to display the results in a meaningful and user-friendly manner. So graphical representation of results is very important in any computer analysis. So if you are doing all the analysis and if you are not able to plot the frequency spectra, or if you are not able to show how the harmonic current is going to be, then there is no use of doing such an analysis, right? So the computer program should be able to plot meaningful results or display meaningful results in a user-friendly manner. So these are the main characteristics or criteria for performing a harmonic analysis using a computer model. So if we are using a computer model, first we should know whether all these parameters are there. It should be able to handle a big system. It should be able to model the harmonic sources, or inbuilt model should be available. It should be able to model it as a voltage source or a current source, and all the transformer connections should be there. And it should be able to simultaneously simulate many harmonic sources and bring out the voltage values. So So all these are the main important requirement for any computer program. Okay. So now let us just have a peek on what are the computer tools available for doing the harmonic analysis. So as I told, it is very important because the harmonic analysis is cannot be done manually. Mathematical analysis is very difficult. We cannot do that. So we need to depend upon various computer tools for the harmonic analysis. So most of the power system problems can be solved with power flow analysis tools like load flow studies. So there are a lot of softwares available for power flow analysis. So most of the power system problems can be solved using that. But for computing the harmonic flow analysis, we have very less tools available. And what we have right now is the circuit model in short circuit program will be very closer to a harmonic flow analysis. But again, it is very time consuming and it is very difficult to solve using such power flow models available, right? But today we have many sophisticated tools available for harmonic, but it was not the case in the earlier time. So let us have a brief history of how the harmonic tools are evolved in the electrical industry. Okay, so before we had computers, because the problem of harmonics started much earlier to computer, introduction of computers, right? So before the invention of computers, before the development of personal computers, there was something called the transient network analyzer simulator. So it was a simulator software, which was very common in those days. It is mainly called the TNA, transient network analyzer. So before the development of computers, we had a transient network analyzer simulator where we used to do the harmonic analysis. But they used to be very costly and it was very inconvenient to use. The main problem with the TNAs are, there are two power sources available in TNA. And the one first power source was used as the line frequency, as the power source of the line frequency. And the other one was used to represent the nonlinear sources. So there was no model separately for nonlinear sources. So out of the two sources available, one was used for line frequency source and the other one was used for representing nonlinear loads. And we have seen in the previous requirements of a computer program that it is very important if you want to know the frequency spectra and if you want to know the resonant frequencies of the system, it is very important to sweep the frequency in a very small interval, like 10 hertz, in an interval of 10 hertz. And this was very difficult in TNAs. Sweeping the frequencies through the system resonance, so exactly identifying the system resonance was very difficult using TNS because it was not possible to take a very short steps of frequency for analyzing because it used to take huge data which was not capable to be handled using TNS. So that was one problem. Then in 1975, there was something called Network Frequency Response Analysis Program. It is called NFRAP. This was developed by Edison and McGraw-Hill. And in 1980, another computer program was developed, which is called McGraw-Edison Harmonic Analysis Program, which is MEHAP. So these were the major tools which were used for doing the harmonic analysis. But during 1980, the development of personal computers, so we started getting personal computers. So when the personal computers started evolving around the 1980s, then there were many programs written. So we know that those days, the programs were written only using Fortran language. And initially, the harmonic analysis programs were also written using Fortran language. And then we started writing in C++. So mainly there were programs where we can input the available information and then it used to compute it and then show the results. So it was such a kind of analysis. But of course, they had their own limitation. Then after that, we had many electromagnetic transient programs such as EMPP. They are used even now. There are EMTP, there's a software called PSCAD or EMTDC. They are the latest tools which are available, which are very helpful for doing harmonic problems. So mainly this nowadays we use EMTP, we have PSCAD or EMTDC, and we have some real-time simulators, very good real-time simulators available now, which can be very effectively be used to do the harmonic analysis. So this is a brief history of the computer tools which were used for harmonic analysis. So far we have discussed why we need to do the harmonic analysis and what are the steps to be followed, how we can model a system, how we can model a harmonic source, and then what are the main requirements of a computer tool for doing the harmonics, right? So now we are going to the next topic, that is we are going to see the various devices used for controlling harmonics or mitigating harmonic distortion. Okay, so far we have seen only the details about the sources of the harmonic, and in the first lecture of module 4 I had given a very brief introduction about the mitigation solutions which are used in harmonics, such as filters, etc. So we are going to deal those topics in a little detail here. Okay, so let us go to the next topic, which is devices used for controlling harmonic distortion. So when we talk about the devices, there are a number of devices available to control harmonic distortion. Now how to choose from those depends upon mainly depends upon the requirements what we have, and these devices can be as simple as a capacitor bank, or it can be a line reactor, or it can be even a complicated active filters, active power factor filters, which are using power electronic converters again. Okay, so we are going to see all those in detail now. Let us take the first one, which is inline reactors or chokes, which are this is supposed to be a very simple, we can say the simplest solution for mitigation of harmonics, but it is very successful in most of the cases. So here what we do, this is mainly incorporated in power converters, mainly in adjustable speed drives. So what we have done, as the name suggests, it is only a reactor, inline reactor. So generally it is connected to the input of the power converter. When you have studied the course on power electronics, or if you have studied the advanced power electronic course, you would have studied that with any converters, DC, whether it's a DC to DC converter or it is an inverter, for any application in drive, when we use a power converter, we connect an inductor in the input side. And you may be studied that it is mainly to smoothen the current in the input, right? So that is what is called the line reactors or choke. So it is basically a very small reactor or a choke which is inserted at the input line input of the drive. So how, what does this do? This is mainly helpful in the case of PWM drives. What happens when you are connecting an input inductance in the input side, this will slow down the rate at which the capacitor on the DC bus is charged. So we have a capacitor on the DC bus on the motor side. So this will this inductor will slow down the charging of the capacitor, and what will happen, this will force the drive to draw current over a longer period of time. So it is just making the current smoothened. So what's the net effect of that? It is to lower the magnitude of current with very less harmonic content in it. So basically we are reducing the harmonic component of the current. But still we are going to deliver the same energy, because the inductor does not consume any energy. So the energy consumption will be the same, only that we are trying to reduce the harmonic component in the system. So here you can see a graph where it is shown how the line inductor can reduce the harmonics in the drive. So it is for a PWM variable adjustable speed drive. And we can see that the introduction of a line reactor has reduced the current distortion significantly. You can see that how it is reduced from 80% to 5%. So as you are, see, if the x-axis is the percentage of the input choke. So if there is no input choke, that means 0%, then your harmonic current distortion is in the range of 80%. Now, as you're increasing the line reactor percentage, suppose if you are putting a 30% reactor, then the distortion has come down to around 45%. Now, further reduce, if it is about 5%, then you can see that it's almost 40%. So we can say here, from this graph, we can make out that with a change of 3 to 5% of an input choke, introduction of an input choke of 3 to 5% of the total KVA, then it can reduce the current distortion from 80% to 40%. So that is the effect of line reactors. But only problem is that this can be used only in the adjustable speed drive. So here, what I'm telling about this 0 to 5% is it is a choke size which is computed on the drive KVA base. So base is taken as drive KVA. How much of the percentage of drive KVA is the line reactor? So that is what is given. So 5%. So that means from for a change in 5%, by introduction of a choke or reactor of 5% of the KVA base, we can reduce the current harmonics to from 80% to 40%. 80% will get reduced to 40%. Okay. And okay, so next picture, this figure gives you an idea of, it is basically a comparison of the current distortion with choke and without choke. So you can see there are two curves mainly. Here, the one larger waveform, the upper waveform, is without choke. And again, so you can say that the current distortion is from 130% to, so maximum you have a 130% distortion. But whereas if you are using a choke, then the distortion reduces to almost 40%. So same thing we have seen in the previous curve also. So here you can see that there's a substantial improvement by inserting a choke to the drive. So as I told, the THD current, THD, dropped from 80% to 40%. So you can see a better reduction in the size of the ASD when it is higher. See here, you can see that the first one is for 5% of KVA ratio. Now, if you are taking 5% of the KVA ratio for the current, then you can say that there is a significant change in the current waveform, right? Without choke and with choke. But as you're increasing the KVA ratio, the THD drops from 125% to 40% for 5 KVA. But at 33 KVA, it is only dropping from around 80% to 30%. So that is what we can observe from this waveform. So basically, by using a line reactor, we can have a drastic reduction in the current distortion in the system. Though we don't have any complicated system, we just have to connect a reactor to the input of the system. Now, that is one solution of line reactor. Now, there is another solution which is using isolation transformers. So you can see some isolation transformers in the figure. These isolation transformers can provide some benefits like a choke, like an inductor. But most of the time it is costly. So just for the reduction of harmonics, we don't connect an isolation transformer. But isolation transformers can help in a different way. So in the figure, what we can see is there are two isolation transformers. One is delta delta and the other one is star delta. So what happens? And we have two ASDs, two adjustable speed drives, and they are 6 pulse in nature. So I don't know if you remember one of the lectures I had told that it is possible to make two 6 pulse converters into an output of 12 pulse converter, because 12 pulse converter harmonic current is very less. So it is easier to make just by having a phase shift of 60 degrees. So that is what is given here. Here you have two adjustable speed drives, one of two, both are 6 pulse. Now we are taking it through the transformer. So in effect, we are getting a 12 pulse configuration. So we can achieve a 12 pulse configuration by supplying one drive through a delta-delta configuration and the other one through a delta-star configuration. So here we can see that first ASD of 6 pulse is connected with a delta-delta, and the second one is connected with a delta-star. And then what happens when we have the secondary of the transformer, what we are getting, the output current is of 12 pulse, and we can see that it is almost a sinusoidal nature. So here we have two separate 6 pulse converters. One is through a delta delta and the other one is through a delta star. And together we are getting a output of a 12 pulse converter. So what we are getting in the utility system is a 12 pulse converter, where the harmonic is reduced to a very great extent. So in fact, we are doing a harmonic elimination here. We are avoiding 5th and 7th harmonic by making it a 12 pulse converter, because in 12 pulse converter, the 5th and 7th harmonics are going to be absent. So that is what we are achieving through this. So this is the use of an isolation transformer, even though you cannot use it separately for in place of line reactors. It can be used in such situations to reduce or to eliminate 5th and 7th harmonics. Next, the second device which can be used for controlling the harmonic is a zigzag transformer. So when we are talking about transformers in power system, there are two most important problems which are faced by the commercial facilities. One is the overload of the neutral conductor, and the other one is the transformer heating. Now, both these problems can be solved using a transformer connection, which is known as zigzag transformer. So it's a typical connection of a transformer. And most of the new commercial buildings are including zigzag transformers on the secondaries to prevent the overloading of transformers. So mainly this is used for overloading transformer, and we can see that we are also achieving a reduction in the harmonics in it. So this figure shows the winding diagram of a zigzag transformer. Here it contains 6 coils with 3 cores in it. And the first coil on each core is connected to the second coil of the next core. And then all the one terminal of the second coils are connected together or tied together, and which is taken out as the neutral. And the faces are connected to the primary coil. So you can see that you have the secondary coils A1, B1, C1 and A2, B2, C2. And we have a common neutral point here. So here the arrangement is such that each phase couples with each other phase, and the voltages get cancelled out. So the advantage of this is that we can eliminate the neutral ground current. So mainly this is also known as grounding transformers. So these transformers are often applied in commercial facilities. This is mainly used to control the zero harmonic or zero sequence third harmonic, triple N harmonics or zero sequence harmonic components in it. So a zigzag transformer generally act like a filter to reduce the zeros or filter out the zero sequence current. So what does it do? It is offering a low impedance path for the zero current to flow. And so this will avoid transformer overheating. And also we can avoid all the triple harmonics from the system. So this is one very effective way of implementing or a device which is used to control the harmonics. So here the advantage is that it can reduce the harmonic content in the system. It can avoid the overheating of the transformers, and it can also avoid overloading of the neutral. So we have seen two methods here. One is the zigzag transformer, the other one is the inline choke. So inline choke is also is connected mainly with the adjustable speed drive. So zigzag transformer can be connected to any commercial facility. Now we are going to stop here. In the next class, we are going to see some more devices which are used for mitigation of the harmonics. So mainly we are going to see active and passive filters in the next class. Thank you.